Vamos a empezar esta clase con un repaso del vocabulario que ustedes han aprendido hasta presente, un poco como siempre. Entonces, por favor, empleen bien las manos y repitan conmigo. Vamos a empezar con los pronombres personales. Yo. Muy bien. Repiten después con las manos y digan al mismo tiempo. Tú. Sí. Él. Ella. Bueno, como ustedes ven, esta noche nosotros no tenemos ningún estudiante presente. Entonces, él y ella tienen que imaginar, él y ella. Entonces, después ahora, vamos a pasar a los verbos. Vivir. Hacer. Escuchar. Lavar. Decir. Preparar. Comer. Gustar. Mirar, si ustedes no comprenden esto sin las gafas, mirar, después poner y tomar. Okay, vamos a repetir estos verbos otra vez rápidamente, ¿están listos? Vivir, hacer, escuchar, lavar, decir, preparar, comer, gustar, mirar, poner y tomar. Muy bien, ahora yo voy a decir estos verbos. Será usted en un orden diferente. Será ustedes entonces de hacer los gestos con las manos. Con las manos entonces, ¿eh? ¿Están listos? Preparar. Sí, preparar. Muy bien. Después, gustar. Gustar, así es. Después, lavar. Lavar, muy bien. Poner. Poner, muy bien. Después, tomar. Tomar, así es. Comer. Comer, muy bien. Después, vivir. Vivir, muy bien. Después de eso, mirar. Mirar, es eso. Ahora, yo voy entonces esta vez a hacer el gesto con las manos. Ustedes van a decir entonces la palabra, el verbo que tienen que decir. ¿Están listos? Vamos, entonces. Escuchar, así es. Hacer, muy bien, bravo. Comer, sí, muy bien. Mirar, así es. Después, tomar, vivir y por fin, hacer. Una vez más, sin que yo diga las palabras en el orden acostumbrado. Entonces, vivir, hacer, escuchar, lavar, decir, bien, preparar, comer, gustar, mirar, mirar quiero decir, tomar y poner. Muy bien. Ahora vamos a ver también los pronombres reflexivos y también los objetos directos e indirectos en español. ¿Qué es esto? Me, te y se. Depende, puede ser se, puede ser le. Vamos a ver esa noche le también. Entonces, una vez más, me, te y se. Muy bien. Ok, entonces, nosotros llegamos por fin esta noche a una presentación de nuestra propia persona. Yo voy a hablar de mí durante algunos o 5 minutos más o menos. Traten de comprender lo que estoy diciendo acerca de mi propia vida. ¿Okay? Entonces, primero, yo me llamo señor Nesbitt. Después, cosa muy importante, yo no sé si va a quedarse, sí. Yo tengo 10, un momentito, yo tengo 10, yo tengo 20, yo tengo 30, yo tengo 48 años, yo tengo 48 años, soy viejecito, yo tengo 48 años. Después de eso, ¿qué más puedo decir? ¿Qué más hacer? Sí, la cama. Entonces, miren, Esto representa una cama. Yo hago la cama. Esto es la cama. Entonces aquí estoy haciendo la cama. Yo hago la cama. Esto es hacer. Después, el verbo vivir. Yo vivo en una casa. Yo vivo en, ¿cómo se lo ve? Yo vivo en el campo. Yo vivo y yo trabajo en el campo, en mi jardín. Yo no vivo en la ciudad. Yo vivo en el campo. Después, yo escucho la música. Aquí tengo música y a mí me gusta mucho la música. Yo escucho la música. Eso no es música. Yo no escucho la música rock. No, ¿eh? Yo no escucho la música rock. Yo escucho la música clásica. Después, ¿qué puedo decirles? Ah, sí, lavar. En mi casa yo trabajo muchísimo. Yo lavo primero los platos. Aquí tengo algunos platos. Yo voy a poner los platos aquí adentro del agua. Yo saco los platos entonces del agua y yo lavo los platos. Yo lavo los platos. Yo soy buen marido, muy buen marido. Yo ayudo en la casa. Yo lavo los platos y también, miren, yo lavo la ropa también. Entonces, en el mismo agua, yo pongo adentro el detergente. Yo tomo, ¿dónde está mi camisa? Está por aquí. Yo tomo la ropa. Yo pongo la ropa adentro y yo lavo la ropa también. Yo lavo la ropa. Después, voy a dejar la ropa ahí. Después de eso, yo preparo también de vez en cuando la comida. Ustedes van a ver. Yo preparo el desayuno. Esto representa el desayuno. Yo tomo un poquito de agua que pongo en el cuenco. Tomo una cuchara, mezclo la totalidad. Yo preparo el desayuno. ¡Qué bueno! Yo preparo mi desayuno. Sabroso. Me gusta mucho. Entonces, yo preparo el desayuno y yo preparo también la cena. Yo soy muy útil como marido, como esposo. Se puede preparar, por ejemplo, una pizza. Yo preparo entonces la cena, la pizza. Yo preparo también, ¿qué más? Ah, hay una cosa que yo no preparo. Miren, a mí, ¿qué tengo aquí? Qué bueno, un pescado. Yo no como el pescado. No me gusta el pescado, entonces yo no preparo el pescado. No gracias. ¿Eh? Entonces, después, yo como legumbres. Aquí, creo que tengo legumbres por aquí alguna parte. Sí. Yo como legumbres, un jitomate, por ejemplo, un jitomate. ¡Oh! Se fue el jitomate. ¿Eh? Y yo como también el brécol. Entonces, las legumbres. Yo como las legumbres. Y también a mí me gustan las hamburguesas. ¿Eh? Me gustan las hamburguesas. Pero no como ahora, porque no quiero darles a ustedes hambre. Después, mirar. ¿Eh? Yo miro muy poco la televisión. Casi nunca. De veras, yo no miro la televisión, con la excepción de esta clase, por supuesto. Y la última cosa, cuando yo vengo en la escuela, yo tomo el coche. ¿Dónde está el coche? Bueno, esto representa mi coche. Yo tomo el coche. Yo tomo el coche. Yo no tomo el autobús para venir en la escuela. Entonces, una presentación de nuevo de mi propia vida. Yo me llamo señor Nesby. Yo vivo en el campo. Yo vivo en una casa. Yo tengo 48 años. Yo soy buen marido. Yo hago la cama. Yo escucho la música. Me gusta la música. Yo escucho la música clásica. Yo no escucho la música rock. Yo, ¿qué más? Yo lavo los platos. Yo lavo también la ropa. Yo no preparo de veras el desayuno. Y yo no preparo la cena tampoco. La verdad es eso. Yo como las legumbres. Me gustan las legumbres. Pero no me gusta. ¿Dónde está? ¿A dónde se fue? No me gusta tanto el pescado, ¿eh? No me gusta el pescado. Yo miro la televisión, pero muy poco. Se puede decir que yo de veras no miro casi nunca la televisión. Y por fin, yo tomo el coche para venir en la escuela. Ahora, yo quisiera que ustedes traten de formar estas frases conmigo. Let me take a look, step back right for a moment here and tell you at what point we've come in this class and in our classes in our elementary school. At the beginning levels, when you're learning a language, there are three, you might say three levels. At the beginning stages, there are three levels of speech. The first is the ability simply to understand the instructor and respond with sí or no. The second level is when you can repeat a memorized phrase back to your teacher, such as buenos días or muy bien, gracias. The third level, which is what we're trying to focus on right now, is the ability to put entire sentences together, and not just entire sentences, but to string numbers of sentences together so that you can speak about yourself or about other people or other things for 30 seconds or a minute or 2 minutes. That's much more complicated than simply repeating back a memorized expression. And so tonight, what I want you to try and do as you're sitting there, as you're watching this show, I'd like you to try and recreate with me the self-description that I just gave you. I'll help you along with my hands. So at home, if you'd please try and follow along and actually form these sentences with me. I'll act them out for you. You say them, and then afterwards I'll confirm by repeating what you should have said. Okay, here we go. Yo me llamo Señor Nesbitt. Of course, you could stick your own name in there if you'd like to. Yo tengo 6 años, o yo tengo 7 años, o yo tengo 8 años, depende de usted. Después. Yo vivo en una casa. Yo vivo en el campo. Yo escucho la música. Me gusta la música. Después. Yo escucho la música clásica. You're doing great. Keep it up. Yo no escucho la música rock. Yo lavo los platos. Yo no lavo la ropa. Yo preparo el desayuno. Acuérdense ustedes que hay 3 comidas en un día. El desayuno, el almuerzo y la cena. Entonces, esto representa el desayuno. Por ejemplo, ¿qué más tengo? ¿Ustedes se acuerdan? Esto es el desayuno. Oh, qué lástima. Qué triste. Yo no les voy a mostrar ese desayuno. Está en triste condición. Entonces, yo preparo el desayuno. Ahora, ¿dónde está mi jitomate? Entonces, yo como las legumbres. Muy bien. Oh, ¿qué está por aquí? Me gusta la pizza. Muy bien. Después, yo miro la televisión. Y por fin, sí, yo tomo el coche. Muy bien. Ok, entonces lo que ustedes deberían de hacer es tratar, después de que esta clase será terminado, de tratar de hablar de sí mismo durante 30 segundos, un minuto más o menos. What you should try and do with this vocabulary here is for 30 seconds to a minute, when this class is finished, try to talk about yourself using this basic vocabulary we've been working on. By the way, you may wonder, especially for the parents who are watching, what vivir, hacer, escuchar, lavar, decir, preparar, comer, gustar, mirar, poner, y tomar correspond to. Well, let me tell you, there are a lot more before the year's over. These are 11 of the 60 most commonly used verbs in any language. And if a student can master these 60 verbs, which we hope to do by the time the year is over, he or she can really express almost any basic idea necessary when functioning in a foreign country. I want to tell you, since we've lapsed into English, I'm looking for my chair here. I want to tell you a story, basically. This story expresses why it is that we're learning to speak a foreign language. Why, to me, learning a language, for me, when I was in fifth grade, I began studying French. Later on, I began studying Spanish. Why I'm so glad, why I'm so thankful I did. My family and I lived in northern France for about 13 years together. And as we were coming to the end of our 13-year stint, this is back in 1998, we had about a month to go before we were about to leave. And getting ready to leave a continent after you've lived there for many, many years is a difficult task. You have to fill out very extensive customs declarations about the container of your belongings, which is about to go on a ship and come back to America. You have to pack up all your belongings themselves. You have to sell your house if it's not already done. And you have to, of course, pack your own personal belongings you're going to carry with you on the plane. So we had a very, very challenging final month as we prepared to leave, made all the more challenging by the fact that we have a very large family. So the task seemed daunting. Well, one day during that period of a month, last month of our time in Europe, I went to the supermarket in the town of Saint-Quentin. And as I was leaving the supermarket, going back to my car in the big parking lot, a gentleman came up to me, fairly short, dark-complected, jet-black hair. As he came up to me, I kind of could guess what he was going to say already. He stretched out his hand and said, "Une petite pièce, monsieur, une petite pièce," which means just a little coin, sir, just a little coin. In other words, he needed money, or he was expressing he wanted money. Often, when you face people in a situation like that, you don't know how genuine the need is. You don't know quite how to handle the situation. What I did at that time was to test really how badly he needed the money, I said, "Can I offer you something to eat instead of giving him money?" I was impressed by the fact that he readily accepted. He was anxious to have something to eat. And when I offered to take him inside and get a pizza inside the shopping center, he went and got his wife, and who was often there. They had a van which they had borrowed from an uncle in Italy, as it turns out. And he brought his wife with him. They came inside the supermarket, the shopping center, and we sat down in a pizzeria and tried to talk. Now remember, we were in northern France. I'm an American. Well, as it turns out, he was Romanian. His name was Sorin Stefan. His wife's name is Mihaela. And they were Romanians who were looking for the chance to establish a life for their two children and them in France, where they could get a better, conceivably have a better lifestyle. The Sorin and Mihailo. Sorin had been a veterinarian in Romania before the revolution occurred, some 10 years ago, more or less, or a little longer than 10 years ago. And he lost that position, and now the family is having great difficulty surviving. In any case, how did I find all this information about them? He didn't speak French. All he knew was essentially, "une petite pièce, monsieur." Well, he didn't speak French, and sadly enough, he didn't speak Spanish, and he certainly didn't speak English, but he spoke a little Italian. The first place they'd tried to find exile, you might say, was in Italy. And though they couldn't stay in Italy, while he was there, he picked up a little bit of Italian. I could speak Spanish, and so what I did to try and get by was to deform my Spanish to sound as much as I could make it like Italian, with a little bit of Italian I'd heard in the past. He spoke to me in Italian, and we stumbled to communicate with each other, but we basically understood. My wife and I invited them to come and live with us for the last part of the last month we were in France, because they were sleeping in their van, traveling about France, looking for a place to settle. As often happens when you offer to help someone else and you think that you're doing them a great service, the inverse is really what's taking place. They end up being much more beneficial to you than you are to them. This couple, Sorin and Mihaela, they, during the last month, did everything they possibly could to help us prepare for that difficult departure from the European continent. They watched our children when we were packing our belongings. They helped us take down shelves and move furniture around. The day when the huge container came, 2 days before our plane was to leave, when a truck brought this huge container to our back door, Sodine was there along with a number of other of our friends helping us pack the container just right so all of our belongings would fit and not be destroyed. And then we got down to the very last morning. We were leaving from Charles de Gaulle Airport in Roissy, which is a city just north of Paris. To get there on time, we had to leave at 5:30 in the morning. At that time, we had only 10 members to our family, and that allowed us to have 20 suitcases. Our belongings had already left on the container for the ship, but we still had 20 suitcases, not to mention the carry-ons, not to mention a lot of little hands to hold on to. And we had to get to the airport by approximately 7:15. It was an hour and a half drive. We had two vans lined up, one for people and one for belongings. As we crawled out of our beds and went outside in the courtyard of our home the morning of our departure from Europe, we had a lot of money riding on that departure. Imagine the cost of 10 airplane tickets from France to America. We had to make sure we caught that plane. Well, what happened was one of the two vans broke down. We went out to start it. It wouldn't start. So suddenly, here we were with only one van, 20 suitcases, 12 people more or less, I think it was, having to get a mile and a half, an hour and a half distance away to the city north of Paris. And because Sodine and Mihaela had been staying with us, they had the large van they'd borrowed from their uncle in Italy, into which we quickly moved all the suitcases, even our dog and our dog inside its cage, and still got to the airport on time. So our last morning in Europe, after 13 years in Europe, we were rescued by this couple that we thought we were helping out by having them come and stay with us. That's really what life is often like that. And not only is life like that, but as far as foreign languages are concerned, if you have spent some time, like you young people here, are devoting yourselves to learning the Spanish language, down the road you will not regret the time that you're putting into it and the effort you're putting into it now. Try and understand the situation. I was an American living in northern France, trying to speak Italian to a Romanian gentleman who himself couldn't speak French, and I was speaking Italian on the basis of the Spanish that I had learned. As you'll find as time goes by, the basic and most important reason, the richest reason for learning a foreign language is the people whom you can know, the people with whom you can interact, the people from whom you can learn, the people who can help you and whom you can help at the same time. So I just encourage you to persevere. You're doing a great job. And in a very short time, I'd like to introduce a series of evenings in our school where parents can come along with their children and develop their Spanish abilities. If you're going to become truly fluent in Spanish, it's going to require a certain amount of travel eventually, maybe a year from now, maybe 2 years, maybe longer. Well, for travel like that to take place, the best way for it to happen is in the context of family. And so I'd really like to give families the chance to develop their Spanish-speaking abilities as well. So you'll soon be hearing from me as to what evenings that's going to take place. We'll try it for a month on an experimental basis and see if the parents can be as sharp as the students have proven themselves to be. Thank you very much. Entonces, hasta luego. Nos veremos la semana que viene. Oh, and by the way, if you'd like to prepare, as a student, you'd like to prepare this oral presentation that I gave today so that you can talk about yourself during a period of 30 seconds to a minute over the next 2 weeks, I encourage you to go to a website. The website for our class is www.theulat.com. ULAT means Universal Language Acquisition Tool. It corresponds basically to the CD and the approach that I use, the CD I've given you. At that site, you'll find a link to review activities. Click on that link, and you'll be led to a self-description that I give of myself, much like you saw here in the class today. It's for you to use to form your own presentation in speaking about yourself. So, muchas gracias y adiós.